Good morning to you. Let's stand to our feet, shall we? Beloved and righteous Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you, Heavenly Father, we can call on your majestic name. We can trust you to hear us because we come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior, who is and has the name above all names, who receives us openly, lovingly, and generously. And we come this morning and we call out to you and cry out to you for your presence to be strong among us. For you, Heavenly Father, to set a watch over our place of worship. For you, Heavenly Father, to have your ministering spirits, your fiery angels, to stand guard over us with swords drawn, warding off the enemy who would do evil against us if he could. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will speak to us this morning. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would teach us something of your nature this morning. Teach us something of your goodness and your mercy and your forgiveness this morning. Show yourself mighty, because you truly are a mighty God, a wondrous God, the righteous Lord. We bless you now, and we thank you in the great name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, well, it's good to see everyone this morning. I hope you've come ready to worship the Lord and as King and Master of this place and in our lives and in this universe. A couple of announcements this morning. Don't forget the Valentine's Day banquet is Sunday, February 16th at 6 o'clock p.m. And tickets are on sale at for $8 for individuals and $15 for couples. Miss Mary Dunaway will be over here by the, is the choir room, correct? Or the right in front of the choir room, right after the service, selling tickets. So be sure and pick yours up there. Wednesday night is the last night you can kind of buy one. We want to see exactly how many we need to prepare food for. So be sure and come and do that after the service today. Don't forget, Beyond Our Walls meets every Monday in the fellowship hall at 5:30. We want you guys to be engaged in reaching the community. Chris and Matt are doing a wonderful job with that, and we want to support that as well. So finally, the baby bottles, the bucket for that, if you have your baby bottles to turn in, is in the office. So at any time, you can just grab a deacon, grab one of us, and we'll be glad to put that bottle up for you or open the office for you. So if you're visiting with us today, we are excited that you're here with us. A couple of ushers are walking down the aisle right now, and they have a little piece of paper. I always forget what this is up here. Bulletin is the name of this piece of paper. I always forget that. I want to say the brochure, but no, it's a bulletin. So if you will grab the bulletin, there's a little tear-off tab on there. That's what makes it the bulletin instead of a brochure. You can tear off this tab, and you can actually put your put some information on here for us. We just love to get to know you, see how we can serve you and love on you this morning. So if you are visiting with us, just stay seated for the first part of our welcome, and members, let's stand and greet one another.
Thank you. together as we sing. For thou, O Lord, aren't you glad we serve a God who reigns? He's on his throne. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This morning, I'm going to share a wonderful anthem with you, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Throne forever reign.
Thank you, choir. I've just got one tongue, but I'm going to use it. Amen. He is indeed holy. He is worthy. I invite you to stand, church, as we sing. This is a Chris Tomlin. Some of you may not be as familiar, but it is called Holy is the Lord. Sing it out.
We stand and lift up your hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and we worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory.
Please pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this time of worship. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us today, Lord. I pray that you would be with Dr. Shear as he goes through his message. I pray that you'd give him strength, Lord. Lord, at this time, we just want to give back just a portion of what you've given to us. Lord, you've been so good to us, Lord. You've given us everything. And Lord, we just want to give back just a part of that, Lord. We ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings and help them to use to benefit your name, Lord, and just be with us as we go through this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Fanny Crosby was one of our most prolific hymn writers. She wrote probably over 5,000 hymns. About 1,000 of them are published in various hymnals. And she was blind from birth, but she has such a great insight to lyrics, and I love all of her hymns. This one is Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. If you are a child of the King, you're going to tell about it. Amen? Let's stand, church, and let's sing.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed. Child and forever I am redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is a theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and more. Shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
Amen. Thank you, church.
You know, Jim and I try to work pretty closely together in worship preparation, and he likes for me, if I know by the time he's preparing things, to share with him what my theme or what my passage of Scripture is so that he can prepare accordingly. This week I told him I was going to talk about the devil, Isaiah 14. He said, well, if you're going with the devil, I'm going with God. Amen. Amen. Find in your Bibles Isaiah 14, if you would, please. Isaiah 14, we're going to read verses 12 through 15 out of this chapter, continuing our study of these great, beautiful, golden passages of Scripture in the book of Isaiah. The Word of God says the following: how you were fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you were cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to Hades, to the lowest depths of the pit. Father, this is your word. Teach us. We ask you in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Little Susie, 5 years old, disobeyed Mama. So Mama sent her to her bedroom for time out. Now, parents, you know as well as I do, you have to go eventually and explain to them why you have disciplined them. So Mama went in there after 15 or 20 minutes, and she said, do you know why I sent you here? Yes, ma'am, because I disobeyed you. Well, do you know why you disobey? She said, no. And Mama said, you disobey because you listen to the devil instead of listening to God. And little Susie cried out and said, I just wish God would speak louder. I want to tell you something. He does, and he speaks loudly through the word of God to us. God speaks to us all over Scripture about the devil and about our arch enemy, his arch enemy. And I want us to study that for a few moments. The truth of the matter is, when I speak of the devil, and by the way, speaking of the devil, we had all kinds of technical problems this morning, so you don't have a PowerPoint. And I'm not surprised by that. I've seen more interesting things happen when you start talking about the Lord's enemy. He doesn't like that. But anyway, it conjures up images in our mind. And sometimes we see this very frightening figure. Or sometimes we see a little red guy with horns and a pointy tail. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You just saw him in your mind when I said it. And the most interesting, I think, that happened to me, I was riding down from the city of Cajamarca in the north central mountains of Peru and headed down these treacherous curves and whatnot, seated next to a woman. I was seated in the aisle and she was seated by the window on this bus. I never rode buses and I just couldn't fit in those things. They're just too small for me, but I had to on this occasion to get where I needed to be for my task at hand. And so I'm headed down and she's talking to me and she says, well, you know, God speaks to me and the devil speaks to me. And I said, well, that's interesting. I said, how do you know God speaks to you and the devil speaks to you? She says, well, when God speaks to me, he sits on this shoulder, on my right shoulder, and he talks in my right ear. But when it's the devil, he sits on my left shoulder and he speaks into my left ear. It didn't help me that I was seated on her left side at the moment. But we have these kinds of concepts of the devil. Here's something that's going to blow your mind. And this is true in Southern Baptist churches as well as across the board. Listen to this. 2009 survey, I didn't get the latest one to come out. This was something I found on Barna's website. But in 2009, 59% of those who claim to be Christian in America, 59% said they did not believe in a real devil. 59%. Now, if someone here questions the existence of the devil, I'm going to teach about him for a few moments this morning, and I want you to learn. But I want to begin and end this message with a very important statement for you. Jesus Christ is Lord, and he has defeated the devil. I don't want you to forget that. Yeah, that's all right, man. Clap your hands. That's something worth clapping about. He loves the devil, that is, loves attention. And I don't want to shine the light on him any more than I have to, because he's so egotistical, he'll think, like that song, You're So Vain, you probably think this song is about you. He thinks that sort of thing. but I'm going to share some things about him and expose him to you this morning. I'm going to begin by telling you about the fullness of the devil. He's full of things. The devil was. Now I need you to go to Ezekiel 28 because we're going to flip back and forth between Isaiah and Ezekiel. But look over there in Ezekiel 28. And in Ezekiel 28, also in verse 12, the word of God speaks to us. Ezekiel 28, verse 12. The Lord spoke to Ezekiel, and he said this to him, "Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre, and say to him," and you say, "Wait a minute, I thought we were talking about the devil." I am, but you need to understand that very, very often when the Lord gave a prophecy, it had a double meaning to it. Just the same as Lucifer back there in Isaiah 14, there's a dual prophecy with the passage about Lucifer and here the passage about the king of Tyre. Both of them are about kings, but both of them are also about the prince of the power of the air. Now, forget that parenthetical information, but it needs to be said. Thus says the Lord God, "You were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardius, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created." I'm going to stop right there. When created, the devil was full of wisdom. In verse 12, that's the first thing he says. You were full of wisdom. I need you to understand something about the devil. And this is stated in Genesis 3:1, but this is something we forget because sometimes we think we're stronger than the devil. You and I are not smarter, and you and I are not stronger than the devil. He is smarter than we are. He's very cunning. He's very, very wise, not in good moral wisdom, in immoral wisdom. Understand that. The devil is an excellent student of human behavior. He sat in that garden long enough to watch Adam and Eve, knowing them and their innocence in that moment, and he knew precisely the right things to ask Eve in order to deceive her. He knew what he was doing with the questions that he asked. Now, he and his demons know your triggers. They know exactly where to poke you in order for you to be tempted. You see, we are not tempted by God when it comes to sin. It's our sin nature collaborates with the devil. And the devil knows what bait to stick out there in order to tempt you to fall away from God, to turn away from God, to sin. He knows precisely what it's going to be. There are things he'll never tempt me with because he knows it's a waste of time, but there are other things he'll throw in my path to get me distracted from the things of God. And he'll do that for you as well. He knows your sin buttons, if I can use it that way. He knows the kind of logic to throw into your mix of thinking in order to get you to sin. So he was full of wisdom. But it also says he's full of beauty. Look there in Ezekiel 28. "You were full of wisdom and perfect in beauty." One of the Peruvian tales about Satan is, and this is in the southern mountains of Peru, that he appears as a beautiful woman. And I said, "Explain this woman to me." They said, "Well, this woman sits by a cave, and this woman comes out, and she has blonde hair and blue eyes and wears a bikini." And I said, well, that's interesting. I don't mean to put these thoughts in your head, but that is one of the things. So I'm talking to two of my young men, Bible students, one day there in the institute that we started. And I said, so I presume maybe as you're telling me this, you've seen, oh yeah, we've seen this. We went up to such and such a cave. You know where it is? I said, yeah, I know where it is. He said, we were out there one night, and she came out of that cave, and she wanted us to go into that cave and follow her. I said, what would happen if you followed her in? He said, why, she'd kill me. But that's what their image was of the devil. Now, you know, I'm not going to argue the merits of their story. I'm not going to argue for it or against it in this moment. That's not my point with this message. But I want you to know he will appear to you however he needs to appear to you in order to deceive you. And if he needs to appear as a blonde-haired, blue-eyed woman in a bikini, I reckon he would, wouldn't he? But if he needs to appear as someone as good-looking as I am, then I reckon that would be your problem too, wouldn't it? You know? Careful. He was full of beauty. But he was also full of worship. You say, what? Where do you get that from? He... Down in verse 13, the workmanship of your timbrels and your pipes were prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherub who covers. Do you know what the angels of God spend their time doing around the throne of God? Jim, what do they do, brother? They praise him. They worship him. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. And they cry out one to the other. The seraphim cry this out. Don't you think for a moment the other angels don't respond? Go to the book of Revelation. Go to the book of Matthew. You'll find where the Bible says the morning stars, speaking about angels, all sang together. And they do this and they praise him. He was full of worship. Now, there are those scholars who say that Satan was the choir master for all of that chorus. I think that's probably true. I agree with that. But there are those who looked at that and said, see, where was music located? It was located in the devil, therefore music is evil. You know, that's kind of like adding 2 + 2 and getting 5, isn't it? Can I tell you something? It was very obvious that God created music and that he likes it. And don't let anybody tell you anything different. He was full of worship. He was also full of light. Now we're going back to Isaiah 14 with this. And his name, Lucifer, carries that very meaning, because Lucifer is a name that means the light bearer. Or, if you will, in the Hebrew, that's Latin, Lucifer. It's just like Christopher is Christ bearer. Lucifer is light bearer. The name means in the Hebrew, shining one. It is implied by Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I think verse 14, when he said, and no wonder Satan himself appears as an angel of light. And he does that to deceive us, folks. That's one of the things that he does. I've seen that angel of light appear many times behind pulpits. I don't think this pulpit, though it's possible I don't know all this about this church in its 75 years. It's possible that some preacher showed up here, a visiting preacher, and was an angel of light to deceive. Anything's possible. Folks, I don't know that that's so. I don't believe it's so, not about 38th, but I do know that I've seen them. I turn on the television and I see that angel of light on several different channels on television, speaking and deceiving and drawing people away from God and away into the snare of the devil. That's what he does. He was full of light. He was also full of self. Look there in Isaiah 14 and look what he said, verses 13 and 14. You have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne. I will sit on the mount of the congregation. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Five times he says, I will. Five times he said, I will. But I have news for you. One time, and it only took one, God said, no, you won't. No, you won't. He wanted to rise up. God said, I'm going to bring you down. It's coming. And let me tell you something very quickly before I get into my next point. He was also full of lies. John 8:44. He is called the father of lies. He's, you know, he doesn't speak truth. And when he does speak truth, he twists it into a lie every time. Can I tell you something? Anytime we lie, we're joining ranks with the devil, folks. You think of that. So he says, I'm going up. Lord said, you going down, boy. You going down. The fall of the devil is something that Jesus said he saw in Luke 10:18 when the 70 returned from one of their missions and they said, why, we saw demons cast out in your name and we saw miracles of healing and other miracles. We saw all of this and Jesus said, I saw Satan being cast down like lightning. I saw it. And Jesus prophesied this and spoke of this. And he saw that as a heavenly thing. So Satan, first of all, when he said, I will be like the Most High, he was cast out. Why? Because sin cannot exist in the immediate presence of God, in that throne room of God, what Paul calls the third heavens over in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. God's holiness, ladies and gentlemen, is so great that our sin requires a covering. Satan could never have that covering. Therefore, Satan had to be cast out of God's immediate presence. Now, somebody will be thinking of Job in this moment and say, but it said he appeared before God in the book of Job. Doesn't mean he came to the very throne room of God. It doesn't mean that at all. It's not necessary. God is omnipresent. God could have summoned him. And by the way, he has to obey God, whatever God says. He doesn't have this opportunity to do whatever he wants to do. I'm telling you, when the Lord says do this, whatever and whoever has to do that, has to, must do it. And so he was cast out, but he had to obey God in God's every command. Not only that, but he has been cast down. You see, he's the prince of the power of the air. He was cast down into the heavenly realms of earth here. He was the prince of the power of the ages and the prince of the power of death. But the Bible says Jesus has cast him down. And the Bible says that when Jesus died and he was there in paradise, in the afterlife, there is paradise and there is Hades. But the Bible says he snatched from Satan. This is in the book of Hebrews. You can look it up. He snatched from Satan the keys of death. He took it right out of his hands. And so that was snatched away from him. This is a wonderful picture for me. And I want to tell you, he was cast out. He's been cast down. But ultimately, he will be cast in to the lake of fire. Revelation chapter 20, there are two verses of scripture. The first place he's cast in is the bottomless pit, and he's held in a pit for 1,000 years. That 1,000 years is the millennial kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. At the end of that 1,000 years, he is loosed from that bottomless pit. I don't pretend to understand all that God chooses to do in his sovereignty, but that is what he says in Revelation 20. And Satan will go around deceiving people on the earth. And you say, how could that be possible? Well, there will have been born children during that time that have never been tempted to sin. Do you realize that? And Satan's going to come along in that thousand year, at the end of that thousand year period. And Satan is going to tempt them to follow him. But he's going to be defeated. And he will be finally and completely defeated. And he will be cast into the lake of fire. And there he will be in that lake of fire forever and ever and ever. You know, the devil is one of these creatures of God that is in some ways, if we were to see him in his diabolical splendor, if we were to see that with these pipes and all of these jewels that he was encrusted with, we would look in wonder and look at awe, in awe at him, and we would think, why, he is fearless. But I want you to know there are things that the devil fears. There are things that he fears. And one of the things that the devil fears is the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The name and the blood of Jesus, he cannot do it. They overcame him, Revelation tells us, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. He hates the name of Jesus. He despises it. You are his enemy if you are a Christ follower. You are his enemy because Christ is his enemy. And that's why. If you are not a Christ follower, you're still on his side. You're still batting for his team. You're still playing against God. Oh, by the way, friendship with the world is also enmity with God. And there are Christ followers who decide, well, I don't want to get carried away with this. I don't want people to think I'm a fanatic, so they salt their tongue with godless language, and they participate in very questionable habits so that they can look like I'm a Christian, but I'm also one of you guys. Friendships with the world is to be an enemy of God. And you're helping Satan's cause, not the cause of Christ. He fears the name of Christ. And now that I said what I said, he fears the Christ follower that walks by faith, not by sight. Can't stand you when you walk by faith. When you believe God and do what God says, when you rise up in the morning and say, this is going to be a day dedicated to Jesus Christ, old demons of hell rise up and say, oh, I don't like what I just heard. I don't like that. And they're going to do what they can to thwart you in that, I promise you. You might get away with it one day or 2 days, but the time will come and it'll come quickly that they're going to put something in your path to make sure you do not follow Christ by faith. They'll do that. But he also fears a church that believes Matthew 16:18, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. You know what that means? The church is on mission. And when a church believes Matthew 16:18 and goes on mission with God, the problems that rise up, the devil says, I don't like that church. I'm gonna find a way to disrupt that church. I'm going to do what I can to get in the midst of that church and mess them up. And the fastest way he does it, he don't fight the church from the outside. He joins the church these days. You got to watch that. Be careful of that. Well, I've shared these things with you, and if I had time, I'd talk about the forces of the devil. I don't have time to deal with that in one short message, but I want to tell you something. You can be free from the oppression of the devil. And I want to show you how very quickly to be free from the oppression of the devil. And I want to give you five quick truths about freedom. And you may want to write these down. The first thing is you have been purchased, ladies and gentlemen. What, do you not know that you were bought with a price? You know what price you were bought with? The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful? You have been purchased. You are not your own. You belong to God. You do not have a right to yourself anymore. The day that you said, I do to Jesus Christ, you surrendered all rights to Him. Now somebody shout right there, because I can't. You've been purchased, but here's the good news. You've also been pardoned. In the name of Jesus, we have redemption. We have redemption, even the forgiveness of sins. Man, I've been pardoned. I was a sorry cuss. I was just a degenerate, obnoxious, obstinate, obtuse individual. And I'm telling you, my Lord God forgave me. I lived for myself, but my Lord forgave me. I made life miserable for others. Just ask my mama. My Lord forgave me. I have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. My Lord forgave me. I've been pardoned. You've been placed into the kingdom and family of God. The Bible tells us we were far off, but now we are citizens, heavenly citizens, Ephesians 2:19, and members of the household of God. Devil don't like that either. So you've been placed, you have been purchased, you have been pardoned, you have been placed. I've got good news for you. You have been empowered. You shall receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 tells us the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and taking into captivity to the obedience of Christ every single thought. You've been empowered. And the devil comes up and he starts messing with you. You just got to tell him to leave. That's all you got to do. Not in your name, not in your power, in the power and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But finally, you must be prepared and put on the whole armor of God, ladies and gentlemen. You have to put on the shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. You have to put on the belt of truth. You have to put on the breastplate of righteousness. You have to put on the helmet of salvation. You have to take up the shield of faith, and you have to hold on to the sword of the Spirit. You must do that. You must prepare yourself. You must prepare yourself today. You must prepare yourself tomorrow. There is no day that you cannot prepare yourself. You need to walk, ladies and gentlemen, prepared with the armament that God has given to you. You know why? Because Jesus is Lord, and He cast Satan down. And he's walking around looking at 38th Avenue and those of you that are visiting with us today. And he's here saying, how can I make their life miserable? Can I just tell you one thing? Satan is the chief of he's the prince of all these fallen angels. And Satan himself, why, he's too busy to bother with the likes of us. He is not omnipresent. He is not omnipotent. He is not omniscient. Neither are his demons. I don't know where Satan's throne is. I suspect it's somewhere in the Middle East, based on Scripture. But I know he has spirits, evil spirits, soldiers of his that he sends to handle the likes of us. They have the same M.O., modus operandi. They have the same M.O. as he does. And basically everything that's true about him and his ways of operating is true about them. You don't need to fear them. I hear people all the time, they just get frightened at the thought of a demon, an evil spirit. Why? We're clothed in the righteousness of God. Why are you afraid of what's afraid of the name of Jesus? His name was Elvis, it really was. Not the Elvis that we all know. All of you have this picture of this black-haired guy with big sideburns now. He had black hair, but he didn't have sideburns. And he came to me and he says, I've got a problem. I said, Elvis, what's your problem? Actually, it was more like, Elvis, ¿cuál es tu problema? Because this happened in a remote part of Peru. And he said, when I walked in here tonight and big cross back there in the back, he said, all these thoughts came into my head. Evil thoughts. I said, what kind of thoughts? He said, well, I don't want to say it out loud. I said, just go ahead and tell me what it is. He said, the thoughts that came to my mind were, cursed be the name of Jesus. I said, yeah, it's pretty bad. He said, I don't understand it because I gave my life to Christ. And he told me how long ago it was, and I don't remember right now. And he says, I have been active in my church. I said, what's happened? Tell me what's going on. He says, well, I've moved into this house. I said, tell me about this house. I said, what's the purpose of this house? He said, well, the owner of the house is a warlock. I said, say what? In Peruvian Spanish, you say, ¿cómo? And he said, yeah, he's a brujo. And I said, so you're renting a room from a warlock? He says, yeah. I said, you're not smart, boy. I said, I got to tell you something. You need to get out of that place. I said, what goes on there? Tell me what goes on there. He says, well, I've seen all kinds of things happen in that place. I said, you need to get out of there tonight. You need to move out now. I said, but in the meantime, I need to pray for you now. And I got on my knees, and the first thing, you know, the devil just puts fear in your mind whenever he can. And the first thing that happened was, you're on your knees. He's going to attack you. Because he was seated up in a chair, and I'm on my knees. I said, oh, he'll have to go through Jesus first. And I began praying for him. And I said, now, Elvis, I need you to pray. And I led the man and taught him something about spiritual warfare. And I said, I want you to understand something. I said, you know what a gnat is. He said, yeah, I know what a gnat is. I said, this demon that's bothering you is like a gnat when it comes to the name of Jesus. You just thump it away. I said, so right now I'm going to let you thump away this gnat of a demon that's bothering you. And I'm going to show you how to pray. And I led him, and we prayed. He wrote me about a year later. And he says, I want you to know I moved out that same night. I am now involved in this, 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 and this in the ministry. God has given me such victory, and I have remembered the lessons that you taught me. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the truth the devil doesn't want you to know is you have victory. You have victory in Jesus Christ. Amen. And that's what he doesn't want you to know. You already won because Jesus won. Amen.